we are going try to give you some ideas about the Cloud FinOps culture to inspire you to embrace this FinOps culture in your company and in your Kubernetes cluster. I'm not alone in this talk. My colleagues, Álvaro and César, platform engineers, both of them, one from Empathy and the other one from Kiko, are here to show us these benefits of Cloud FinOps. And, well, I forgot myself, Ramiro, platform engineer too at empathy.co. You can find us in GitHub, Twitter, or you can find us around this event with this t-shirt and all the week around the KubeCon. Okay. We are so passionate guys. Therefore, as soon as we start reading about the Cloud FinOps culture, we fell in love with that and we use a lot our company to embrace this culture. Therefore, I'm going to do a brief introduction about the FinOps foundational. César is going to show us the architecture of the tool, and Álvaro is going to show us some actions, some dashboards, and some takeaways of this FinOps tool. As DevOps revolutionized the development by breaking down silos and increasing agility, the FinOps increased business value of cloud by bringing together technology, business, and finance professionals with a new set of processes and culture. As you can see in the FinOps culture, all teams work together, from exec to business engineering or platform engineering and finance. Every team has different motivators to drive spend and savings, and all the teams should work together to, with a little bit of empathy, to align each other goals. To sum up, FinOps help to align all the teams to organizational goals. This looks pretty good in the slides, but how can we start? Okay, the FinOps life cycle can be reduced to three phases. The first phase is the info phase, where we are going to focus on the give visibility and resource allocation to the different teams. In this phase, to getting started, defining a task allocation strategy is a key to have a common language between all the different teams. After that phase, we can go ahead to the optimize phase, where we can save cost easily, right-sizing the workloads or simply reducing the underutilization workloads. And the final phase is the operational, where, as always, we are going to automate everything and embrace the culture of all the company. As on our journey, we realized that the vast majority of the cloud providers doesn't allow us to, they only show us a cost report, but there is no way to see the cost of the Kubernetes workloads that are running under IKS, GKE, or whatever. Therefore, the main motivation was to give this visibility to the teams, give the teams the possibility to see the impact of their actions. What happened if they upscale a workload? What happened if they forgot to delete an unused stateful set? Or what is the impact of their action on the build? And all of that with a near real time feedback. We don't want to spend a couple of days to have a metric-driven cost optimization because it's a couple of days later. Although there are some third-party alternatives, the vast majority has license cost and you don't know what is happening under the hood. Why not to do it in the house? Why not to do it open source? There, we are happy to share with you these links. This is the Kubernetes core repo that you can enter, review it, use it, whatever you want, to take some ideas or inspiration, and besides the Grafana dashboard. Now, Cesar, our master and commander, is going to show us a little bit of the architecture. Cesar.
As Amira said, we didn't find anything in the market that fulfill our requirements, so we have to create our own. We didn't want to reinvent the wheel, so we have used some of our current infrastructure to do the job that is the proper tool for doing that. So here you have a high-level diagram how the system works. So first we have developed a custom service that retrieves information from the cloud provider API. And then we have our current installation of Prometheus that will scrap these metrics that the service aggregates, and with some recording rules that we already have pre-configured inside of the Prometheus, we'll transform the data. So finally, we can show this all these informations with Grafana to our managers or a developer's colleague. Before I go deeper how the exporter works, let me explain you two things. So first is the machine times. Machine times define how many resources a machine a VM has in the cloud provider. So for example, M6i large has in Amazon Web Services, it refers a machine with two CPUs, 8 gigabytes of RAM. There are tons of different machine types in Amazon, and divided in different families. Also, I want to talk about the instance type, that this is how the cloud provider tariff given machine time. And there are two types of machine types. The on-demand one, that we know from how much it will cost for a given period of time, and the spot, that this price will vary, will change along the time. And this depends of the availability of these matching types in a availability zone. So let's check how the microservice works, so the exporter works. So the exporter is a Kubernetes deployment that is written in Go. We have provided all the Terraform necessary scripts to allow this exporter to query the cloud provider. And also we have developed the Helm chart for an easy installation and easy and to work easily with the Kube Prometheus stack. So, but this, what exactly that? So this, as I told you before, this is retrieving the prices of the cloud provider API and aggregating this data in several metrics. The three most important are this one, that the instance cost, that represent that the cost of a given VM or instance or machine type, the instance CPU price, that it will give you the price of one CPU for this machine type, and the instant main price, that it will do the same for 1 gigabyte of this machine type. There will be several combination of Prometheus labels depending of the instance type and the availability zone where this machine runs. And with all of that, it will be easy for us now to calculate all the workload cost of our colleagues. And Alvaro will explain you that.
Okay, so it's my turn to talk about taxonomy, which, you know, taxonomy is just a classification. You know, when we talk in Greek, that's why doctors talk in Greek and Latin. Like, it sounds imposing and important, but it's just a classification of cost, okay? So we want to know how much you are spending, because something is, money is something that is simple to convey, right? And what is the cost? In which workloads we are spending the money, and in what resources, okay? So instead of just throwing a bunch of definitions right there, I'm going to walk through a small analogy, trying to explain what we calculate, how we calculate it, okay? So imagine that we want to build a deposit of water. Pretty stupid analogy, but that's it. So we want to serve water to individuals. Okay, so we go ahead and we ask, okay, how many gallons of water do you need? And there's one individual says 103 and the other 3. And we say, okay, then we have to build our deposit with 106 gallons of water. Then we put one extra there available for anyone to use. I don't know, maybe one day you get home, all covering math from playing soccer, whatever, and you need a little bit extra. That's okay, we can cover for that. We make a deposit of 107 gallons. We have to pay for that water. And then when we get our bill, there's something else in there, right? Like we have to pay for being connected to the main distribution system. We have to pay for methane equipment, whatever. So there is something else in the bill that we cannot relate directly to an individual. It's something that everybody pays, and that's what we call share cost. And then when we look at a little bit deeper into it, we realize sometimes that an individual said, okay, I need 103 gallons, but then that individual is only using three. So we have to guarantee that 103 are there, but there are only three being used. Nobody else can use them. And we have to, they're just there, idle, doing nothing. And we have to pay for that. That's what we call underutilization, okay? So we can have some idle resources, either because we have available for spikes in load or whatever, and to accommodate these spikes, or because someone has requested them, but is not using them. And that's it. And now enter Kubernetes for the plot twist. So basically, instead of having one deposit, we have several deposits, some bigger, some smaller. These are the machines that Cesar has explained. And that's our Kubernetes cluster, right? And then instead of serving individuals directly, we serve namespaces, households as in the picture, and then individuals that are pods. And we can have the same, exactly the same logic in there. How many resources are being requested? How many are being used? If there is a difference, there is some underutilization in there at the pod level, at the namespace level, at the cluster level, and we should not forget about these share costs that we have to pay for spinning up a cluster in the cloud. Okay, so that's the taxonomy right there. There's nothing else. We want to know how much we are spending in use resources, in resources that are being requested that we have to pay for because someone is asking them from us. Okay, if there is a difference, we have some underutilization, which usually is not good. We can have something available just in case to accommodate for spikes in loads. We know there will be something idle, either for accommodating these spikes, either because someone is kind of hoarding it, if you allow me that word. And we have some share costs in the cloud to spin up a cluster. Okay. And that's it. So we focus on the cost of CPU, resources, and also persistent volumes. So we can calculate those resources and we can get the prices, as Cesar has explained. That's it. We combine that and we can get some dashboards. And that's the whole idea, right? Is to get in a Kubernetes cost report. Right? So we want to give visibility of the cost of the workloads. We want it to be near real time, as faster as we can scrape from issues, because as Ramiro said, there is usually a delay of in the order of days in the cloud, and usually you get the cost of the cluster, not the workload itself, and we wanted to do it open source. Okay, so now this should be a live demo, but you know, live things usually go wrong. I mean, you are wondering, this is not supposed to be my teaser, okay? So it was supposed to be given to me live, live things usually don't work. So we have some screenshots, I'm sorry about that. So first of all, a disclaimer, the numbers are not real. This is something we just spin up for the occasion. Okay, so the numbers are fake news completely, but we wanted to show that we can get how much a cluster costs, how much we are spending in idle resources, because either they are idle because we have just them for accommodating spikes load, or because someone is requesting them but not using them, kind of hoarding. How much are we spending really, really in using resources in our workloads? How much we are spending just to spin up the cluster in the cloud, and the cost of our persistence? And we can divide this as much as we want. As Cesar has explained, maybe on machine types, on instance types, so we can get which ones are better for depending on the workloads we have, the evolution over time. We can get this at the namespace level. We can get this at the pod level. That's okay. And now you want some more. The point is, we have to calculate the resources, calculate the cost, right? So, why don't we get a usage report? I mean, at the end of the day, if we have to decide if we need to delete a workload or right-size it, or maybe we just move something into Kubernetes and we need to know actually what is that using. Talking in terms of dollars doesn't really make that sense. Better to talk in terms of CPU and memory, right? So we also have dashboards for that. So you can get CPU or memory you are using, you are not using, what's the usage of your persistence. We can get if your workloads are setting requests, setting limits, what's the quality of service the cluster is giving to those workloads. We can give some recommendations on what maybe it's a good point for resources, for requests, for limits, for the, your persistence. And now that I'm getting closer to the end, what I want to talk is about the future, what we plan to do with this is, okay, we can give visibility to everyone on what's the cost on the resources they use in the cloud, okay? But this is visibility, right? So we wanted to maybe get some reports or at least getting some traceability or tracking those costs and trying to see, okay, are we doing better? Are we doing worse? Are we saving actually something as time passes? Then talking about sustainability, which is something even more important than cost, is that now some clouds are starting to report what's the carbon footprint of the resources you can pay for or get buy from them. So if we can get the resources and we can get this carbon footprint, we can get the carbon footprint of our workloads, which is very interesting. And we are even thinking about stuff like Kepler, maybe you have heard of that with eBPF, or we're just making up our mind about that. So, but it's a nice way, a nice path to follow in the future. And also talking about spot or preemptible capacity, we are doing calculations now per hour. That's a little bit tricky to do that calculations. And we would like to go like per minute to get a more granular way of how those are actually charged in the cloud. So that will be like the very, very next step we want to focus on that. And as takeaways from the talk, this is now getting close to the end, is just we wanted to give visibility to the cost to inside a company, to give trust, to give sustainability, transparency, something that is openly accessible, that we can get in a timely manner. We want to make informed decisions in terms of where we can cut some expenses. And in order to make informed decisions, we need information. That makes sense, right? So we want these decisions to be driven by the business value of the cloud. And we want also to bring in ownership, cost ownership. I mean, teams or circles or whatever, or tribes, whatever you have in your organization, whatever you call it, but try to bring some ownership into the cost of what they are using in the cloud. It's not just the operation guys spending money. We spend money because someone is asking us to spend that money, right? And you have there the GitHub repository. You can go there and see the code. You have the dashboards in grafana.com. You want to use them. You can find us in Twitter. And so use it, break it, report a lot of bugs. We are more than happy to get your feedback. And that's actually the end of the presentation, but I will leave this slide just in case you want to check it out. And if you have some questions, well, I'm more than happy to answer them.